What I'm going to talk about instead is really what I think are some of the philosophical questions that emerge from the shift to a certain kind of cinematic medium or form that we knew to the entire phenomenon of YouTube. Oh, yeah. Is this fine? Yeah. So on the 21st of August 1911, Vincenzo Perugia left with the Mona Lisa in his hands, and he left instead an empty space there. And I find this to be a very interesting and a paradoxical image, because curiously, more people came to see the empty space than they had come to see the Mona Lisa. And this idea of the blankness and the empty space as signifying this kind of the heart of, you know, the disappearance of a certain kind of a signifier and what it leaves for us to imagine was kind of repeated. And this is in a story by Zizek, when he talks about how with the collapse of communism in Eastern Europe, there was this momentary kind of, you know, aporia where there were all the rebels who were waving the flags, except that there was no new national flag. So they had the old flag. The only thing that they could do was to carve out the red star from the flag. So here they were waving this kind of empty flag with the red star that was missing. It seems to me that the present moment that we're living in terms of the transition from kind of forms of media theorization and forms of theorization of mediatic experience, we're looking at a stage where there is this kind of moment of blankness, where one is not sure what to do with the older kind of modes that we had, you know, whether it was the stuff that we inherited from film studies or media theory, to make sense of this proliferation of what's been happening in the domain of new media. And I want to open out a few questions, really about this idea of how we can focus on just one site in which a lot of these issues, from questions of political economy, to technology, authorship and appropriation, curatorship and censorship, all emerge. And that side is really YouTube. First, a few statistics. There are over 800 million unique visitors to YouTube each month. There are over 4 billion hours of video that are watched each month on YouTube. And there are over 100,000 hours of video uploaded to YouTube every single day. This boggles. I mean, these statistics seem to make things less rather than more intelligible. And I think there's a real kind of an urgent need for engaging more seriously with what's happening, since the only people who seem to be otherwise producing a theory of new media is, of course, the state. And that narrative is a familiar one, which we've all kind of been hearing in the last few days. It's a technophobic kind of approach combined with a political opacity that makes for a very kind of heady combination. The fiasco of what happened in Bangalore around the entire rumor of attacks on people from the Northeast, etc., and the subsequent backlash, which I'm sure we'll talk about more in the last session. But in 2009, Carl Dauber of the Strategic Studies Institute authored a book called YouTube War, Fighting in the World of Cameras in Every Cell Phone and Photoshop on Every Computer. And the title more or less summarizes and frames the entire issue and what, you know, follows in the book. But I want to read out one segment of one paragraph from the book, because one part of the story is familiar enough to us. It's the, you know, post-Baudrillard story of violence as a media event. But in the next portion of the book is very interesting. He says, "Terrorists and insurgents are now no longer dependent upon professional media to communicate. In fact, to an unprecedented degree, the professional media have become dependent on them. This is due to technological developments which permit any terrorist to film, edit, and upload their actions virtually in real time, whether Western media are there to witness or not." So one of the signs of the time seems to be that the paranoia and suspicion that engulfs the technological subjects produces a kind of range of recognizable figures. There's the pervert in his cubicle, there's the terrorist wielding the cell phone, and there's a pirate in the network. Now, some of the work that I've done in the past really deals or attempts to kind of investigate these discursive figures. But what I'm interested in doing today is a slightly different phenomenon. I'm interested in looking at a far more quotidian, ordinary figure of the producer of culture in the realm of spaces like the YouTube. This, for example, is, believe it or not, YouTube's most watched video of all time. And we're talking here about something like 6 billion views. Has anyone seen this video here? Yeah. Oh, okay, yeah. You're a fair number of people, yeah? I mean, it's... I have seen this video over and over again. You know, as a media, as someone attempting to understand media, there is this threshold limit that I find myself in often when it comes to YouTube to make sense of this entire phenomenon. There is a genre of categories in YouTube videos, and they're called the WTF videos, which primarily signifies this entire perplexity of how is it that these videos are being watched over and over again. And that's something that I want to try to make sense of. This is a far more talented one. This is one of the second or third most watched, which is the evolution of dance. But Judson Leppi is also the new YouTube star, as it were. So YouTube is creating this entire phenomenon of new stars, new kind of, you know, content creators, etc. Now, there have been a number of attempts at kind of giving a political economy account of this. And one of the most influential of these was something that was done by Chris Anderson in his book called The Long Tail. Chris Anderson was the editor of The Wired. The argument of Anderson was really in terms of trying to understand the move away from what he describes as a blockbuster principle, arguing that the Pareto principle, I mean, everyone's familiar with the Pareto principle was simply that, you know, over a period of time, Pareto found that 20% of people in society control 80% of the wealth, and that was something that was mirrored in every aspect of social life, whether it's in the idea of the organizing of the market. So, for example, 20% of all the books in the world will account for the sales, whereas 80% of the books will never be sold. Or 20% of films are the ones which will be the hits, 80% of them will never be watched. But it's this 20% that accounts in a way for the entire market. So this Pareto principle that begins, as it were, you know, to dominate, and we know this to be true of the film industry in India, of the music industry in India, etc. And what Chris Anderson does is to challenge this idea by describing what he describes as the long tail. He says that the Pareto principle very typically has a very long edge on top and a very, very narrow, you know, tail. But what he says is that what's happening with the internet economy is that you have the emergence of a much longer tail, right? So, and here he cites a few very interesting statistics. He has a conversation with a music entrepreneur who runs something called Jukebox, and he's asked by this entrepreneur to guess how many of the tracks which are available on Jukebox, which is over a million, have sold at least one copy per quarter. Now, the Pareto principle would naturally say, you know, 20% or so. But the answer stuns Chris Anderson because the answer is 98%. So 98% of the tracks have sold at least once in each quarter, which means that there is this crazy niche market where it's not a very successful market. It's not a blockbuster market. But there is this market that's emerging for all kinds of you know, media commodities and media goods, which would otherwise not have been available at all. So the challenge that that Anderson poses really is, how does one thicken and how does one widen the long tail? And that's the question. And he says that there are a couple of factors that enable the long tail. The first one is, of course, the democratization of the means of production. The fact that you have, you know, the ability to make, let's say, your own music and to circulate it online enables you to enter a market which is otherwise determined entirely by per square foot basis. So the argument was that, you know, if you take the way, let's say, a crossword or a landmark works, it works entirely on the logic of how much space a book occupies. So it's calculated on a per square inch basis. So if a Chetan Bhagat is going to sell 150 copies a day, it justifies its existence over a long period of time in, let's say, a landmark. And every independent distributor knows this to be the problem. The problem is that you do not have a long shelf life in a bookstore. You do not have longevity. You do not have visibility, right? You're immediately hidden. If you don't sell, you're taken out of the market, etc. So the long tail, one aspect is this democratization. The second thing is the democratization of the means of distribution, which is the extension of this shelf life, because technically the shelf life of a book can be extended infinitely. So even if you do not have visibility in the way that you did in a landmark or a crossroad, it doesn't really matter, because you can technically have a sample of your book available online in perpetuity. The third is the connection of the demand and supply. Now, one of the things that is crucial to all of this is, of course, the entire question of viral networking and word-of-mouth culture. And he has a very nice phrase where he says, you know, what happens when ants have megaphones? And I want to take this question because I think while YouTube is indeed the best example of what happens when ants have megaphones, people like Anderson have provided us with an overall sense of what is happening with these new technologies of distribution, but we rarely get a sense of the philosophical questions and consequences of this shift. What is happening in the long tail in terms of this phenomenon of the Charlie bit my finger kind of logic? What is it that people are producing? What is the logic of the circulation of certain kinds of videos and images, and what does it say of our times? This is an image. I actually had an embedded video, but it was on a Mac, so it doesn't play. But these are the back dorm boys, and they are in some ways the first superstars of YouTube. For those of you who are not familiar with this, the back dorm boys were basically two Chinese students, Huang Zhiying and Wei Wei, from the Guangzhou Academy of Fine Arts in China, who became instant celebrities when, in a state of boredom, they made a lip-sync cover version of a very popular Backstreet Boys single using nothing more than a cheap single digital camera on their computers in their kind of dormitories. And it's and for those who haven't seen the video, they're incredibly, incredibly talented. And this is this video was the first one to propel them into stardom at a time that if you on YouTube typed Backstreet Boys, the first hit that you got were the Backdoor Boys. Right, and the second video that you got was the official Backstreet Boys song that they were. I want it that way. Now, people decried their fame and said, let's face it, it doesn't take a lot of talent to make faces. They didn't write the song, they didn't sing the song, they didn't play any musical instruments. Their sole accomplishment is that they made faces at a camera. That's not talent, man. And if they weren't Chinese, that is, if they didn't have the freak factor of Chinese boys lip-syncing to Backstreet Boys songs, nobody would have noticed this. This was the initial kind of response that came. And yet the fact of the matter is a lot of people noticed it. The Backdoor Boys, apart from the cult developing around them and various kind of internet memes that were devoted to them, now there are hundreds and hundreds of versions of this kind of the Backdoor Boys. They were also featured live on NBC and both dropped out of their academic programs to become hugely successful brand ambassadors and spokesperson for some of the largest media brands. Right? This is the ironical kind of reappropriation that always happens. They both acquired a celebrity status and are now role models on television channels, hosting their own shows. So the first challenge for me is that how do you make sense of this kind of phenomenon? Amongst media theorists in East Asia, they use a phrase called kuso to describe a range of media content on YouTube, on what I would describe as the micro content, right? There's an entire range of, because the entire format of YouTube, which is the less than 10 minute video, is the emergence of the microstars and the emergence of this kind of micro contenting. So East Asian theorists use this idea of kuso. Kuso, the root words of kuso are from Taiwanese, which is from kusoge, which is also a Taiwanese and Japanese mixture. The word kusoge is a portmanteau of kuso and game, which literally means shitty games. The introduction of this category or a category such as this is to teach gamers how to appreciate and enjoy a game of poor quality, such as appreciating the game's outrageous flaws instead of getting frustrated at them. So kuso refers to the situation of not only how does one make things into garbage, but also how do you turn garbage into things. It started as a subcultural phenomenon, but is now highly popular in mainstream cultures, on reality TV, on youth-oriented channels like MTV and Channel V, and in local performances. Nishant Shah, a media theorist and cybercultural theorist, poses a question of the readability of these digital objects or events. And he says, how are we to make sense of this kind of junk that is available on the internet, and how do they become cult objects? Rejecting the idea of parody, citing the fact that the idea of parody and its deep-rootedness within a certain Western paradigm of intertextual practices do not actually capture the sense of what's happening, Nishant Shah argues and suggests that if we place their production as kuso, it allows us to realize that the objects that are being parodied in the video are not American popular cultural forms, or specifically Backstreet Boy videos. What is being parodied is the original self of the performers. In the Backdoor videos, what we see is a lifestyle choice that is coded in consumption of cultural forms, accessories, appearances, class differences, language, and most importantly, the conditions made available by technology. The original object, then, are the three boys and their real or original status and their lived practices. In other words, even as Nishant rejects the easy and by now passe categories of appropriation and bricolage, which were fashionable, you know, when postmodernism had its 15 minutes of fame, what he's unable to do is to move beyond the other familiar lens that we've inherited from cultural theory, namely resistance and performance, especially of gender identities, are equally themselves formulas that have been familiar to many cultural studies approaches to understanding youth culture. Interestingly for me, Nishant Shah uses the phrase new digital cinema to describe this entire range of micro content that's produced specifically for a platform like YouTube.
The question that I want to pose is, what are the consequences of using cinema as a paradigm of understanding these practices? The emergence of photography and film as new media at the turn of the 19th century unsettled the ontological stability of the visual arts. A century later, you see a similar destabilization of film with the emergence of a wide range of visual practices enabled by digital technology. So what are the consequences of the shift from celluloid to digital for film history and film studies? How do we make sense of the shift of the ontological basis of cinema in photography to the emerging realm of the immaterial digital image? The technological question is a very crucial one here, because very often the very format of the small screen and the various technologies of encoding video are inseparable from the kind of experience that one has of the image itself. So in the case of a lot of the YouTube videos, the idea that you're creating it for a screen of a particular size and encoding it in a manner that you want it to stream in an efficient manner is also the question of what is the language of the camera that one speaks of when one speaks about YouTube videos. Because more often than not, these videos are created by people sitting in front of their computers. And what is the recording device is not an external camera, but really the camera that's embedded within the computer device.
In one of the guides that was written on how to create better YouTube videos, because you can see this entire language of authorship, quality, taste, etc., is not gone entirely. It resurfaces in a very different way in the YouTube world. So there's an entire guide on how to make better YouTube videos in which Wandick uses the term snippet to refer to the transient status of a clip within the potentially endless process of reusing, recycling, etc. And he says, play to the medium strength. Know that your video will be seen in a tiny window on a small computer screen and then shoot it accordingly. Use lots of close-up, keep the background plain, avoid long shots, and employ simple images with high contrast. Visual subtlety is not your friend. If the camera was an apparatus for staging a mise-en-scene, then here it is replaced by the computer or the camera within the computer. And these digital objects or events share both an immediate proximity but equally a distance from cinema. If cinema was about a spectatorial experience, the simultaneity of the spectator-producer on YouTube seems more complicated and stabilizes the very idea of what constitutes a work itself. Geert Loving, following Lev Manovich, instead characterizes the experience of watching YouTube videos as the experience of databases. He says, we no longer watch films or TV, we watch databases. Instead of well-defined programs, we search one list after another. It's always the promise of the next video, the video that throws up in relation to a video that you're watching. So you're never watching a single work. You're always watching a database work out through the logic of the search results. Now, this seems to be very similar with the experience of pornography online, where we have to admit that contemporary pornography is less pornographic in the sense of a reference to sexual material or sexual content, but more in terms of a reference to forms of distribution and circulation. Describing an experience of surfing porn on the internet, a feminist writer says, I caught myself clicking through to a gallery, taking in the contents with a glance, and backing out to click through to the next gallery. I didn't need to spend much time with the pictures to feel the titillation of porn. That's what gives me a hint about what it must be like to be obsessed with online porn. That the search, as much as or more than the pictures, is really what turns you on. No individual picture or video can be as novel or as exciting as you hope it will be, so you keep searching and looking, looking and searching. You're never satiated, because if you just masturbated to any particular picture or video, you'd miss out on all those other ones, right? So it's this endless idea of the click-through, right? So pornography is no longer about the good old-fashioned having a page of a magazine open and, kind of enjoying yourself. It really is about this constant traversing through a database. So how are we to make sense of this kind of economy of the excess of the image? Loving characterizes the sheer volume of videos on YouTube as the YouTube sublime, invoking the Kantian sense of, the sublime as the sense of being overwhelmed by, in his case, natural phenomenon translated into aesthetic categories. But I would try to look at this in terms of a certain idea of understanding it in terms of a frenzy and the accelerated logic of circulation. In his work on early visual technologies, Jean Comelli describes the intensification of the visible produced by early visual technology and the production of what he calls the field of the visible as direct human vision of events, places, and bodies began to be mediated by an optical apparatus that sees in place of the naked eye. Now, Linda Williams, borrowing from Comelli, describes the visual hardcore knowledge or the hardcore porn pleasure that's produced by pornography as a frenzy of the visible. I would argue that pornography on the internet and as a way of understanding our own spectatorial practices seems to produce something akin to the frenzy of the real or the frenzy of the live. And in this case, the real is specifically referenced through its immersion in the domain of the private. The explosion of sexual scandals via the leaked MMSs, which circulate incredibly on the internet, seems to suggest something of this nature. The turn in TV towards reality TV, the popularity of live webcam transmissions, the rise in sexual scandals like the MMSs all share a common ground in their quest for an unmediated reality. Digitalism then seems to exist at the cusp of an inability to believe in the hyperreal on the one hand, and an intense desire for the real, which is grounded in degraded and unintelligible images, as though quality becomes the marker of the relationship to indexicality. And I want to show you an interesting example here. Oh, this is another one which has always perplexed me. This is called How Can She Slap? And this is basically a leaked kind of video of a reality show, which is really tragic. It's about this kind of thing that goes horribly wrong. But there are now hundreds of memes of this from Afghanistan to, you know, the US, to from Netherlands to Germany. There are hundreds of memes of this, and you know, one really can't make out what's happening. Some of them are extremely well done, extremely talented versions of this. But the example that that I want to show you is a very interesting example of someone called Vishal Gupta, who was kind of this, you know, he was having fun in front of a webcam and figured that if he placed his index finger and his middle finger, and he drew, you know, with an ink pot, kind of black ink, he just made a mark between the two of them. He figured that if he placed his fingers before the webcam, he could simulate a naked woman. So he starts this web telecast, and soon he has hundreds of people who are chatting with him, asking him to perform for them. Now, there is something absurd about this image, because apart from the sheer, you know, ridiculousness of it, he then places his thumbs on top of them to simulate breasts. But this idea that there are hundreds and hundreds of people who are chatting with Vishal Gupta and trying to, you know, follow this kind of live performance, how are we to make sense of this desire for the degraded image in a time when you have pornography of all kinds in very high definition available for you? So there is this, you know, there is this kind of paradox there. In the realm of cinema, you have a move where all films tell you that we have X being 12,000, 13,000 special effects, right? So there is a move for the hyperreal. In Michael Mann's film called Dillinger, there is an attempt to create, as it were, an imaginary filmic history in terms of, you know, so there is all kinds of examples of this. Jodie Foster's Contact, in which the director was not happy with a particular expression of Jodie Foster. They change it digitally. They alter it. So it doesn't matter if you can give a performance of a certain kind, because that can be digitally altered. And yet at the same time, there is this move towards the degraded and the downward image. So let me try to kind of bring this together. I will suggest that the various digital objects that could be seen as artifacts of an incipient digitalism are yet to find a taxonomy, leave alone an ontology. The puzzle of what a digital object or a digital event is recalls for us questions that were popular in classical film theory, which have been out of fashion for a while, including the various shades of realism, from ontological to perceptual to photorealism, etc. It's not surprising that the digital moment has also been accompanied by a return to various figures of classical film theory, including Bazin, Epstein, Balazs, etc. A critical component of the loss of the cinematic experience is an account of the change in the heightened experience of cinema in ourselves, since the theatrical experience entailed a commitment not just to our solitude, in space and time of theater, but a solitude that we shared with others, whether intimate or strangers, in the presence of something larger than ourselves, call it the screen or the world. So if you were to take the classical experience of the Platonic cave as being that of theatrical experience, there are two things that are at play. There's proximity and there's size. So even as the screen was much larger than life, you shared a proximity with strangers or with intimate people of a very close nature, even as you had a great distance from the screen. The first shift that happens is, of course, when you move the screen from theater to television, where all of a sudden the screen is much smaller. The proximity that you had is also much closer now, but the space that you shared with those around you is also altered, because it's more an intimate space. It's the family or it's the living room. The television comes and radically alters the architecture of the Indian middle class's house, because everything then becomes centered around the television screen as the mediator, as it were, of space. So this idea of the transformation that takes place between proximity and size gets further complicated the moment you start watching films on your computer. And here I'm talking about the desktop, not the laptop yet. Where all of a sudden the body is now, you know, kind of straightened up again, because once we were watching television, our bodies had loosened, we were lying down and watching it. Here you had to sit over again, and there were only a maximum of 3 or 4 people who could watch it, but your proximity to the screen was even greater. The screen had become smaller than the television as well. And finally, the condition under which most of us watch, you know, films now, which is on our laptops, lying alone very often, watching the film. So the proximity between screen and you gets even closer as the proximity between you and other people kind of completely increases. You're more often than not watching films on a laptop alone. If you were to take the example of horror films, a genre that we all enjoy, but we enjoy specifically in the company of other people. We all get scared of horror, but we don't get scared of it because we watch it in the company of other people. People who really enjoy horror films will admit that they rarely watch it alone, because this is a marker in a way of a certain isolated experience that was not there with classical cinema. So if one were to take this kind of the ontological duration of these moments as mediums move from, let's say, old media to new, how are we to think about the philosophical consequences? One could speak a lot of the work that's been done by Stanley Cavell on the idea of the screen as that which is not just screen the world away from us, but screens the world to us. Okay, let me wrap up. So if cinema offered us, so arguing against the strand of media theory, which sees a turn towards the digital as an increasing process of disembodiment, Mark Hansen would argue for a return for an engagement with the experience of the body in new media. For him, the digital era and the phenomenon of digitization demarcates a shift in the correlation of two critical terms, media and body. Hansen argues that as media loses their material specificity, the body takes on a more prominent function as a selective processor of information. It is the body's scope of perceptual and affective possibilities that informs the media interfaces that we encounter. This means that with the flexibility brought by digitization, there occurs a displacement of the framing function of medial interfaces back onto the body from which they themselves originally sprang. But the body itself in this encounter with media becomes a site of indetermination. If cinema offered an image of the world and ourselves to it, what happens when these screen images are replaced by mirror images which are grainy and blurred? In one of his stories, Borges remarks that mirrors and copulation are abominable since they both multiply the numbers of man. What seems to be at stake with the multiplication of technologies of image making is not a settling off, but a furthering of our ontological restlessness. Cinema offered the body one plane of connectivity to sensation, but any change in medium offers another form of connectivity. By moving away from the known plane of analysis, namely the ideal form of cinema, to the micro content that we see on YouTube, we begin to approach media in an untimely manner which allows us to see them as unstable objects which are both less than and more than cinema. And in this regard, the question of ontology is inseparable from that of medium. A medium is that which stands between us and the world as representation, and it returns us to our perceptions by way of the self-consciousness of the medium. And the argument, I suppose, would be how do we actually become a little more self-conscious of the various kind of mediums that have emerged, rather than taking them on as just qualitative kind of deviations from known forms of old media. I'll stop here for now and take other stuff on the Q&A. Thanks.